What's up, guys? It's time for another update on the XEB Plus Neutrino Launcher plugin. If you don't know what that is, you can go watch these two videos. This update isn't quite as substantial as the last one I did a proper video about, but it does contain some much anticipated features. Before we get into that, though, I just want to mention that I've set up a GitHub wiki for the plugin. On it, there's a compatibility list page that's currently very incomplete. If you've been using the plugin, I encourage you to go over there and add the games you've played to that list. Neutrino has compatibility that's similar but not quite identical to OPL, and currently this is the only attempt at creating a Neutrino-specific compatibility list that I'm aware of. I also need the community's help to get a certain highly requested feature over the finish line. You don't even need any coding skills in order to contribute, but I'll cover that more in the second half of this video. For now, let's go over the new update. If you already have Neutrino Launcher version 2.0 or later, you can update it by just extracting the XEB Plus folder from the new plugin package to the root of your USB drive and overwrite all the old files. As far as new features and changes I've made since 2.0, the first one is that I finally figured out a way to further optimize the artwork caching routine. The initial cache build now runs 20-30% faster, and refreshes that don't copy any new files usually finish in under a minute. I achieved this by indexing the names of all the artwork files to a table in memory and checking each game against that instead of reading the files directly. This massively cuts down on the number of required disk access operations. As you may recall, the PS2 has an abysmally slow USB interface, so anything that can reduce the amount of data sent over it is good for performance. I've also added an option in the plugin settings that goes through and removes unused artwork files from the cache. This feature was actually present in the very first version of this plugin I released, and it would run automatically after each cache refresh. However, that implementation wasn't compatible with the multi-device framework I developed, so it had to be scrapped for version 2, but now it's been redeveloped and re-implemented. Both of those features have actually been part of the stable release for a little while now. The first thing that's truly new to this update, version 2.3, is the much-anticipated UDPBD loader. This functionality was developed by Mega Bitmap and allows games to be loaded from a remote network share. The setup process for this is a bit involved and is different from that of the other device loaders, so I'm going to take the next couple minutes to go over it. First, you'll want to make sure that both the PS2 and whatever computer you intend to use as a server are both connected to the same local network. For best results, you should be using Ethernet cables for everything, but a good Wi-Fi connection can work in a pinch. Next, you'll need to prepare the server. Create folders called CD and DVD at a known location on your computer, and copy all of your disk images into the appropriate folder. Next, you'll want to extract the UDPBD sync app folder from the plugin package. If you're on Windows, you'll want to run UDPBD for XEB Plus GUI.exe. This application both manages the server and replaces the list builder tool that you'd normally use to add games to Neutrino Launcher. Over on the PS2, you'll need to boot into WLaunchElf, go into Settings, and configure the PS2 to connect to your local network. Make sure it's set to use the same subnet as your server, or these next steps won't work. Save your settings, then back out and navigate over to the Miscellaneous section and select PS2Net. Make sure it gets an IP and head back over to your computer. In the GUI, you'll want to select the location of your CD and DVD folders and put in your PlayStation 2's IP address. Then press the sync button. This will generate the list file with all the games on your server and automatically send it to the PS2. You can also check this box to download and transfer artwork at the same time, but I had trouble getting that to work, so your mileage may vary. Once everything has been synced, click Start Server and launch into XEB Plus on the PS2. All the games on the server should now show up in the Neutrino Launcher UDPBD menu. If you configured everything correctly, you'll be able to launch and play them without issue. If you're on Linux or have a home server, there is a version of the sync tool and UDPBD server software you can use instead of the Windows application. Right now it's all command line only, not that that'll be a problem for you home lab folks. You'll also have to compile it from source. A full setup guide for both the Windows and Linux versions has been added to the README over on GitHub, but I do need to emphasize that I did not make any of the PC side software for this. That was all done by Mega Bitmap, so if you have any questions about the UDPBD loader setup or configuration, he's the one to ask. He also has his own video that goes over this whole process in a bit more detail, so definitely give that a watch if you get stuck or need clarification on anything. Now for the other big feature in this update, cheat support. I've integrated a piece of homebrew called Cheat Device into the game load sequence. If cheats are enabled, this program will be run before the actual game, and it works exactly like an action replay or Game Shark, where you can enter cheat codes or select them from a database. My implementation here is actually pretty clever. Each time Cheat Device loads, the plugin first sets the database to one specifically for the game that's been launched. That way, the only cheats available will be for the game you're about to play, and you don't have to scroll through a massive list to find them. The cheat database files need to be named by game title ID and placed in the CHT folder on the root of the USB drive containing your XEB Plus install. Note that the cheat format used here is slightly different than that used by OPL, even though they share an extension. Once the cheat device files are in place, you can select Enable Cheat Device from the context menu. When you launch a game, it will load into Cheat Device first. You can enable whatever cheats you want, and then start the game by going to Start Game, and choosing the second option under Disk, which is this massive file path. Right now, the only collection of cheats that uses both the correct format and naming convention are a set of widescreen patches that I've converted and put up on GitHub. Cheat Device comes with files that contain actual cheats for over 3,000 games. The issue is that these files contain no metadata or really any uniquely identifying information that can be used to accurately associate them with a title ID. I made a couple attempts at writing a script to automatically rename these based on the cheat data itself, but I was only able to accurately identify around 300 files. The only other solution I can think of is to painstakingly go through and rename thousands of files by hand, which I'm certainly not going to do. If someone else would like to take a crack at it, or can figure out a better way to automate this process, that would be extremely helpful. The other changes this update makes are pretty minor. Instead of jumping between letters, the L2 and R2 buttons now scroll the list 15 items at a time, and the L3 and R3 buttons jump between letters. By the way, thank you to everyone who responded to that poll. I've also slightly increased the delay before loading in background images per this feature request. Now for the part I actually need the community's help on. I've been working on adding virtual memory card support to the plugin, which isn't too difficult, at least conceptually. There have been some technical challenges involved that I didn't fully anticipate, but I likely could have had a very basic VMC implementation in place from the very first release. The reason I didn't do that, and the reason there's still no VMC support in the latest update, is that a straightforward implementation would fundamentally break one of the PlayStation 2's lesser-known features that I consider to be a key part of that console's user experience. Arguably, it's less a feature and more just a side effect of memory cards being able to hold save data for multiple games. On the PS2, any software that makes use of a memory card has full access to everything on that memory card. That centralization and lack of oversight is why a bug in the first pressing of Jack X Combat Racing can fill the entire card with garbage data, or why that one Beautiful Joe demo was able to just format entire memory cards unprompted. While those things were obviously unintentional, quite a few PS2 developers deliberately took advantage of that unrestricted memory card access in the form of features that would read save data from other games. The example that always springs to my mind is again from Jack X, where you can unlock Ratchet as a playable character if you have a Ratchet deadlocked save file on your memory card. Other games have features that range from carrying the same profile across multiple games in a series, to something as subtle as small changes in dialogue if a certain save file is present. There's also the case of multi-disc games, where both discs use the same save file, despite each disc having its own title ID, and that brings me right back to the problem faced with implementing virtual memory cards. In a perfect world, it would be possible to write all PS2 save data to a single virtual storage device with no upper bound on capacity. That's not possible, because VMC images have to be pre-created at a fixed size before they can be used. The largest memory card capacity the PS2 can theoretically support is 128 megabytes. In practice, that limit is much lower, because quite a few games are unable to read and/or write data to memory cards larger than the standard 8 megabytes, and many titles that can take an incredibly long time to do so. Because of these limitations, the standard way to implement virtual memory cards on the PS2 is to create a new 8 MB memory card image for each unique game title ID. 8 MB per game is a pretty negligible amount these days, and keeping everything segregated like this ensures that every game will always have enough room to save, and won't run into compatibility issues with larger memory cards. The problem with this method is obviously that it breaks all those previously mentioned features that rely on multiple titles sharing a single memory card. Therefore, any software that generates or assigns VMC images needs to have conditions in place to account for instances where multiple title IDs should be assigned to the same card. Multi-disc games are the most obvious case that needs to be accounted for, because not doing so would make it impossible to complete many of them. Luckily, that's pretty straightforward. There aren't that many multi-disc games in the PS2 library, and they're already very well documented. The real challenge is in all those cross-game features I mentioned. I want to keep all of those features intact when using virtual memory cards, and ideally make the process completely seamless for the end user. That means I need to predefine sets of games which should be grouped together according to these features, and that's where things get tricky. We can conceptualize a pair of games where one can read the other's save data as having a directional link between them, and from there it's not too difficult to build up a little network of titles that all need to share the same memory card. The problem is that, as far as I can tell, no one has ever made an effort to properly document these networks or the groupings that they form. All the information I currently have about cross-title save features in PS2 games comes from either my own memory of playing them as a kid, or from a couple of forum threads I found where people were discussing these features and giving examples. Based on the information I've gathered from those very reliable sources, I've been able to put together this list of groupings of games that need to save to a common memory card. It may not be entirely accurate, and I'm certain that it's incomplete. For instance, I've read that you can use a single player profile across multiple EA Sports titles, but I have no idea which ones those are, so there isn't a grouping for them in the list. I need the help of the community to document these relationships between games and fill out the list of networks that they form. On the GitHub wiki I mentioned at the beginning of this video, there's a page for cataloging the groups formed by these cross-game interactions. I encourage you to add to it if you're aware of any that I've missed. Before you jump in and start making edits, though, there are a few nuances to be aware of. The main thing is that I'm not actually interested in cataloging links between games, but rather links between PlayStation 2 title IDs, and that's an important distinction. A single game can have up to 3 or 4 completely separate title IDs. My goal is to get all of these relationships documented completely and accurately in a relatively short time frame. Reason being is that the final set of save data groupings is going to be hard-coded into the Neutrino Loader plugin. I want to get this all documented and done right on the first try, so I don't have to worry about it again. Now, before I completely wrap up this video, I need to make a correction from the last video I made on this project. I have been informed that it is possible to use FreeMC boot with an XFAT USB drive. You just need to use BDM Assault to add XFAT support to it. Personally, I'd still recommend just using PS2 BBL since the XFAT support is baked in, but it's not the only option. Anyway, go contribute to the wiki, subscribe if you want to see future updates, and once again, a big thank you to everyone who continues to help out with this project. I'll see you guys later.